Welcome to Wednesday night at Rocky Hollow. We have a great night tonight. As you notice, Paul and Christy are gone and a few others are gone on this cruise where we're hoping to have a wonderful time. Looking at weather forecast, I'm not entirely sure they will, but let's hope. So you have the B team tonight, but we have some amazing talent in the B team, so we're going to do our best to make it pretty close to an A team. And we're going to start by singing Bless That Wonderful Name of Jesus. Yeah, feel free to stand up.
Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Oh, bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Oh, bless that wonderful name of Jesus. No other name I know. Sing that wonderful name. Wonderful name of Jesus. Praise that wonderful name of Jesus. Praise that wonderful name of Jesus. No other name I know. Bless that wonderful name.
Singing. All right, we're going to do something a little more calm right now. Bring it down just a notch. And I need to be capo one here. Footsteps of Jesus.
Sweetly, Lord, we have heard thee calling, come follow me. Lead us to thee. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever we go. If they lead to the temple holy, preaching the word, or in homes of the poor and lowly, serving the Lord. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go.
And let's slow down a notch and just make it a little bit more worshipful. If you can remain standing and feel comfortable, that would be great. If you need to sit down, feel free to sit down. But if you can remain standing and want to, we'll sing a couple worship songs. Emmanuel and I Love You, Lord. Here we go with Emmanuel. I better take a capo. Kelly, we turn it over to you.
Thank you, Wayne. Thank you for filling in the gap, standing in the gap. Paul leaves a pretty big gap, doesn't he?
He does, yes.
I mean, music-wise.
That's what you meant.
Yes, I knew you knew what. I knew you knew that. I was just thinking when we were singing that last song, I appreciate you directing us to sing it a cappella. I can remember the first time I ever heard and sang that song. It was at Southwestern Seminary in evangelism class. Our professor would start every class session with a cappella music. All these preacher boys in there singing songs like that. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. That's what a preacher's supposed to do, right? Lift your voice. Yeah. Calling people to come to God. I want a couple of announcements as we get started tonight. Well, couples retreat. Maury and Linda and I met yesterday afternoon to make some final preparations for our couples retreat on November 8 and 9. It is going to be a ton of fun and I think very helpful for all of us. So if you have not signed up yet and would like to, please do so. There are still some spaces available. I also wanted to let you know tonight that in addition to the CDs, and Janie told me there's, what'd she say, $10,000 or $12,000 already given to the building fund as a result of that. That this week, thanks to Karen Quillen, Karen's another one of those cruising tonight. Karen ordered these nifty little flash drives, got the worship place on one side and on the other side, All to Him I Owe, Kelly Barnett song. So you plug that thing into those of you who have automobiles that don't have the CD player, it probably has a USB drive. So if you'd prefer to have that, there'll be some of those available Sunday for your taking. Yeah, I got in a nice little bag. Thank you to the Tuesday Fellowship group for helping us with those. So thank you so very much. Okay, so tonight we're going to pray and then we're going to get into our study. We're going to leave the Jordan River. We went to the wilderness. We're going to come to Capernaum, but I have a surprise for you first. So come, let's gather and pray. Indeed, we lift our voices in worship tonight. And our voice says to you, Father, fill us. Fill us with your Spirit to overflowing. We want more of you. Not just knowledge about you, but we want more of you. Just fill us up, Lord, to overflowing. Let us drink from our saucer because our cups have overflowed. We open our hearts and our minds to you. We open your word and we ask you, Lord, speak, for we're listening. Father, we too want to pray for our family, some of them traveling, the choir concert, for example, cruise. We pray for safety and blessing. We pray, Lord, that as they sing, people will hear the good news of Jesus Christ and hearts will be touched. Lord, that your Holy Spirit will fill each person, each voice, and those who are in the audience will hear you speaking to them through these lyrics of the songs. And people will be drawn to you, some in revival, some in salvation. But Lord, we pray for a great success in that ministry of the choir. Thank you, Father, for Scott Cameron and Nancy Hill and for their participation in that. Lord, bless them, we pray. Lord, we pray for our family tonight, Lord, that we know that there are many people who their hearts are aching. And so, Lord, we pray for your comforting spirit. We pray for your hope that comes through the filling of your Spirit. We pray, Father, for peace in our hearts. Lord, we pray for you to fill that empty place that only you can. We thank you, Father, for this privilege, this freedom that we enjoy tonight, and for those who help to ensure that we have that freedom. We pray for our country, these great United States of America, and for every person who's here. We pray for our enemies. We pray for peace. Amen. Okay, we are going to Capernaum, right? All of us, speaking of, we're talking about following in the footsteps of Jesus, right? As E.M. likes to say, none of us were born here in Sun City. All of us moved here. We moved from somewhere. And that's what Jesus is doing tonight. He's moving. He moved from Nazareth to Capernaum. And all of us, as I ask about people, you know, when you moved to Sun City, what brought you here? Family, children, grandchildren, typically. Second most important or numerous reason is to get out of the snow. Haven't seen any of that lately, so you ought to be happy. But a few folks moved here because they retired. They wanted to move here and play golf and, you know, enjoy Central Texas and that. All of us have some reason for moving here. Jesus moved to Capernaum from Nazareth. And we could ask, Jesus, why did you move to Capernaum? And he might say, well, I wanted to live on the lake. How many of you have lived on the lake? Well, a good many of you, yeah. I have talked with several people today about fishing and such, and I have determined that some of the saddest people in our church family are people who say, I sold my boat. I'm serious, yeah. If you want to be sad, that's a sad day when you have to sell your boat. Some people say that the two happiest days in a boat owner's life are the day that you buy it and the day that you sell it. But the people I've talked to today, they were still sad because they don't have their boat. Jesus might have moved to Capernaum because he wanted to live on the lake. He lived in Capernaum. I mean, it's right there. Remember, we went last week. We're going back there just to take a view again. Some people might say what Jesus said, he just wanted to get away from Nazareth. I mean, Nazareth has a reputation, you know. Can any good thing come from Nazareth? You know. Nazareth was a very political place, too, I think. You know, there was, as we understand it, historians tell us, a great number of military people there. Now, Killeen is a pretty nice town, military-wise. Have you ever been to Leesville, Louisiana? Anybody want to go back to Leesville, Louisiana? They call it Sleazeville, Louisiana. Yeah. Fort Puke? Yeah. It's a wonderful place to leave. Yeah. Jesus could have left Nazareth, could have gone to Capernaum because he wanted to get out of Nazareth. But we know, we don't know all the reasons, but it makes good logical sense that he moved from Nazareth to Capernaum to begin his ministry about age 30, which would have been probably about A.D. 27. And he got started there. So, you remember last week where we were? We went down on the Jordan River. We got Jesus baptized. We went out into the wilderness, and we wandered out there in the wilderness and the temptations and stuff, and Jesus comes back. I have here a bottle of water from the Jordan River. And under one of the seats in which you are sitting, if you'll reach right under the seat, on that little rail right there, you'll feel a piece of paper. One of you will feel a piece of paper if you're in the right seat. If you don't, nobody finds it. You might ought to reach to the right or the left and see. Man, there's a seat in this sanctuary, and there's a piece of paper on it, stuck on it. And whoever has that seat, maybe you'll get it next week. Huh? Water from the Jordan River. Huh? No? Didn't find it? Well, okay. Yeah. Next week then. Are you ready? Well, I've got some of the same slides and a few others, but here we are. Here's our map again. Thank you, people. Is that Barbara up there? Barbara Lyons, thank you for running there. Huh? You found it. I won't throw it because it's a glass bottle. Yeah. See me afterwards, and you found the sticker. Next week we may have something else stuck under there. So. Okay, here we are. Here's Sea of Galilee, right? This is Israel, right? Judea. Lower part of Israel, upper part of up here would be Syria. So here's the Sea of Galilee, and here's, well, that's hard to read, isn't it? Nazareth, Cana, Tiberias, and there's Capernaum right up there, Capernaum. So. I think I have a closer-up shot here after a while, but check that out. What is our next slide showing us? I didn't get a copy of the slide, so I don't have that with me. Okay, there we are. Remember, we saw this picture last week. This is an aerial view, an angelic view of the area that is archaeologically uncovered of Capernaum, ancient city of Capernaum. There's a lot more of the city, but this is the part that's been excavated. And remember we talked about how we would park our bus out here and walk down this little way and come through the gate right there. And interesting buildings. there's the white limestone that we're accustomed to here in Central Texas, and then there's some rock called basalt. Is that right? Yeah. B-A-S-A-L-T, black-looking stuff. And this building right here, this big building, is it looks almost like a checkerboard, those white and black stone. But there's a lot of that around. In fact, over here, if you looking along this fence, all these things, there's some cylindrical-looking grain-grinding stones out there. So anyway, we'd walk in here and we'd walk down, and remember we looked at that, looked like a buggy with wheels on it for carrying the Torah, you know, the scrolls. We'll see that again in a moment, but you'd see that as you walk right down here. We'd sit under the tree for a little bit, and our guide would tell us all about Capernaum. Again, this is the headquarters. This is where Jesus lived and where he called some of his disciples and got in a boat and sailed to the other side. You know, I mean, this is a major place. And so one of the questions we want to answer is, why Capernaum? How would that be a good place to start a ministry? Remember, too, that this is the synagogue. The synagogue, remember, is a place primarily of teaching the Torah, and place of, you would meet here weekly, but then you'd want to go to Jerusalem, and that's some, 80 miles south of here. You'd want to go there for the festivals, if you could, especially for Passover. And if I understand it right, if we're on the northwest corner of the Sea of Galilee, I mean, it goes way around here, right? Then Jerusalem would be yonder way. So this is a more recent building. It's actually a church that was built over the top of what some people believe to be Peter's house. There are some people who disagree with that. You're able to go through a little gate right there and go down and walk on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, where I think we can be just almost 100% certain that you'd be walking right on the same spot where Jesus walked 2,000 years ago. That's nice. So, but here we are. We're at Capernaum, and I want to read a couple of scriptures for you to get us into the context. We're 80 miles north of Jerusalem. That wouldn't take long in a bus, depending on traffic. Hour and a half or probably something like that, because most of these, they're not like Highway 130 where you can do 80 miles an hour. But I want to read a couple of scriptures to get us into the context. And one of them is Matthew 9:1. Let me go to Matthew 9:1. To get us into the context. Getting into a boat, he, that is Jesus, crossed over and came to his own city. Now that's a reference to Capernaum. So the gospel writers are referring to Capernaum as his own city, the place where he, Jesus, lived and worked and ministered and called disciples. So Matthew 9:1. From Nazareth, he comes to Capernaum, a significant move, I would argue. And some of the rationale that seems to me that a good reason to move to Capernaum was that it's on a major thoroughfare, major highway. A lot of traffic would come through there, and people coming from all over. Remember, too, the context, the cultural, political context is that this is not Israel anymore. It ceased. In fact, that part of Israel went away in 722, right? Yeah, 722, when the northern half was taken away. And so it's under the rulership of the Roman Empire. Yet they have a king of that area, Herod, and his sons then afterwards. So it's a larger city. How large a city? Well, my research suggests, and it's quite difficult to determine. How do you determine the population of a city when all you've got is the archaeological digs? Well, they determine the size of the city and try to determine the capacity of population for the city. So Capernaum, population somewhere perhaps between 6 and 15,000 people. 6,000 and 15,000 people at the time of Jesus. Quite a bit larger than the little village of Nazareth. Plus, it's on a major thoroughfare. People coming from all over. And thus, Jesus would have the opportunity to teach people as they came through, perhaps. Or his disciples would have opportunity to minister to people. 30 miles northeast of Nazareth, 80 miles north of Jerusalem. And the name Capernaum, as I understand it, means the village of Nahum. Probably not the prophet Nahum, but village of Nahum. So there he is for perhaps a couple of years. And Jesus is making this his headquarters. He will go from there and other places and return, teaching, preaching. So when Assyria defeated the northern kingdom, 722 BC, before that, that is 722 and previous, this area around the Sea of Galilee belonged to the tribes of Zebulun and Naphtali. And we know that that's a reference also in one of the other scriptures that I'm going to bring up in just a moment. Matthew 4:15, I believe it is. In fact, I'll go to Matthew 4:15 right now. Matthew 4:15. Matthew chapter 4, verse 15 says, "The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles." Galilee, you know, remember, is a region area. It's not a city, but a regional area. Galilee of the Gentiles. So prior to the Assyrians, 722 BC, it was the areas of Zebulun and Naphtali and in Israel. Early in Jesus' day, there was probably 50% Gentiles in that area, according to some historians. So if it's 50% Gentile, then where are those Gentiles from? Here are some of the suggested areas. Egyptians, Arabians, Phoenicians, as well as the Hebrew people. So there's a lot of people from all over. What would he call it? A metropolitan area. There's folks from all. So Jesus, again, and his disciples have opportunity to meet people, speak to them, teach them, and they go perhaps all of these other places. Remember, Herod, the son of Herod the Great, now he's ruling this area, and he's what they call a vassal king. He's the ruler, but he's got somebody. He's not the king as in nobody can touch me kind of king. He's like got a fella above him that says, tax time, pay up. If you want to be king, pay up. So Herod is taking taxes from the people to send to Rome, taking taxes for himself. And then there's also the temple tax that people have to pay. Some historians have argued that at the time of Jesus, the people of Galilee were paying 28 to 33% tax. I didn't hear any moaning and groaning. That's because you're used to that, right? And remember, there's not a lot of industry. This is a very agricultural kind of area. They have agriculture as in crops, and the crops would, in fact, including today, some of the crops would be, they grow some cotton in the area. I saw a lot of, and this was just north of the Sea of Galilee, pomegranate trees, olive trees. What else? I wrote a few things down here, what I saw. A lot of alfalfa, dates, and I did say olives, didn't I? So a lot of agriculture, but there's didn't have any oil wells. Ha ha ha, right. Why would they need oil wells, right? I remember when we went to Jordan, the Jordanian guide was telling us, you know, we don't have anything. We don't have any of these natural resources. That's over there in, Iran, Iraq, and places like that. So God just gave us a good disposition. And so the Jordanians have invited all these refugees from other countries to come, and their population is growing tremendously as a result of that. So again, people challenged by the taxes. In fact, as we read the scripture, the New Testament, the Gospels, how often does it talk about the poor? And if you're paying 33% tax, you probably are falling into the poor category, aren't you? Taxes, about money management, these large landowners, and then the managers of that land. In fact, Luke 16. Luke 16, it talks about, let me just read it. Luke 16, beginning of verse 1, Jesus told his disciples, he's telling them a story that they would relate to very readily. There was a rich man whose manager, this would be a rich man, and he had somebody managing the property for him. And the manager was accused of wasting his possessions. And so the landowner, the rich man, called in the manager and asked him, "What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management, because you cannot manage any longer." In other words, you're about to be fired. Show me the books. And the manager said to himself, not to the owner, "What am I going to do? My master is taking away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig." In other words, don't want to labor. "And I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do so that when I lose my job, people will welcome me into their house." So he's a manager. As I understand it, there's you don't see a middle-class population at this time in this area. It's either rich people, poor people, not much in between. So if a farmer can't pay his taxes, what happens? Same thing that happens today. The government comes and takes over your property, and you lose everything, forecloses on it. How many times did Jesus teach about borrowing? He says, if you take a person's coat, their cloak, be sure and give it back to them at the end of the day, because that's all they have to keep warm with. Big divide between the rich and the poor, not a lot of middle class folks. Luke chapter 12, we see how the rich got richer and the poor got poorer. And also you see how the times that Jesus fed people. I can't help but think about the time in this country that I've only heard about from people who lived through it, and that is the Great Depression and the lines just to get food. And my grandparents telling me about, living out in the country, you survive because you raise some hogs and cow if you could for milk and whatever in the garden kind of thing. I remember my mama saying, "We didn't know we were poor because everybody else was too." These are poor people. These are people that are looking for, where's my next meal coming from? If you've been to third world countries, you know what I mean. I remember when after we had, my unit had been in Afghanistan for a while, we started doing these civil affair trips out into the community to try to build relationships with the local people. And so I, a bit naive as I was, I said, sent emails back home and said, "Y'all send school supplies." Because girls, remember under the Taliban, the girls couldn't get an education. They couldn't go to school, just the boys. And so now that because of the kicking the Taliban out, the girls could now go to school. But they didn't have any pencils and paper and things like that. So some of us would email back home, and people would send school supplies, boxes of things. And so we'd store those up, and about every week, 10 days or so, we'd get to go outside the wire and go out into the communities and take these school supplies. And of course, also, being the chaplain, we had this small, we called it our engineer chapel, where our battalion of engineers would worship. And of course, people, this was early in the war, right, 2003, and people were sending stuff, these care packages. We had candy out the wazoo. Yeah. And so people would bring in their hard candy and stuff and put it in this foot tub that we had in the chapel. And we'd sack up a bunch of that stuff and take it to those kids out in the village. And I remember this one particular day, we went to a village, and the elder, the man in charge, mayor, whatever they called him, he said, "You better let me pass out the candy, that they'll run over you." And so he held up whatever they call those, shirt tail, and we poured that candy in his shirt tail. And so he's walking around, you know, and those kids are, I didn't think he was going to survive. I was glad that I listened to him and let him have the hard candy. But we'd go into these villages, and, you know, it struck me that, you see any agriculture, there wasn't much of it. And I wondered, how do these people eat? But I do remember this one thing that I had the privilege of flying from base to base all over Afghanistan, because our engineers were everywhere. And we'd fly to these places, and sometimes fly in a helicopter, sometimes in a airplane, but oftentimes in a helicopter, and watching just the terrain and such. And I kept seeing these funny-looking spots, bright spots on the ground, sort of teardrop-shaped spots. And finally, we got low enough and close enough that I could see what it was. And sure enough, it was a threshing floor, like in the Bible, where they'd take their grain and, crush it, and then they'd throw the grain into the air, and the wind would blow the husk, the chaff, away. And that stuff that blew away was, piled up in the tear. I thought, man, here we are 2,000 years, and people still trying to live like that. Poor people. Jesus said, "You'll always have the poor with you." But he never did say, "Disregard the poor, because you'll always have them." He helped them. Poor, a lot of poor people in Jesus' day. I think that had a lot to do with where he went and how he ministered. In fact, I know I'm getting off script here, but just trying to follow in his footsteps. You remember people wanted to take him. Scripture says take him and make him their king. Why? Because he could feed them. That sounds sort of familiar, doesn't it? We want our government to take care of all of our ailments. Yeah. We're all looking to somebody to help us take care of our needs. We need each other. So Jesus was there. So we go to the synagogue in Capernaum. I showed you the ark, the sign. Can you bring that picture up of that little stonework? Okay, that's probably a couple of hundred years after Jesus' time. And there's that piece of artwork that would be probably on the synagogue, and that would be an image of perhaps a cart. Well, why would they need a cart for the scrolls? Well, because there were several of them. One thing perhaps. But also because, you remember in the Bible, in the Gospels, we read about the ruler of the synagogue. It may be that the ruler of the synagogue would take the scrolls to his house for keeping, safekeeping or whatever, and bring them back. Or, as some have suggested, that the synagogue is supposed to face Jerusalem. You know, when you worship toward Jerusalem, and this one was built in such a way that they would need the ark, for the Torah on wheels, so that they could put it in place and then move it out of place. But interesting stuff that I don't know a whole lot about. But it's very interesting to see these things and try to make sense of it. Jesus there in Capernaum. Now, so what did Jesus do? What was some of the first things that he did when he got to Capernaum? He called some disciples. What kind of disciples did he call? Fishermen. Yeah. Jesus was one smart man, calling fishermen. Why would fishermen make good disciples? Well, you have to be patient to be a good fisherman, right? You have to be patient and endure and, deal with all kinds of, I don't know. But I did have a couple of pictures here that I wanted to show you, but did they ever make it through, Barbara? Okay. All right. Okay. So tell me about fishermen. What do you know about fishermen? Huh? They're patient. What else? Uh-huh. Patient. Hardworking. They what? Away from home a lot. And yeah, we've seen those things on TV where the fishermen, you know, the high risk, they go out into the North Sea or whatever and get our lobsters and all that kind of stuff. And can be very lucrative at times. And as we know, at least two times in Peter's experience with the Lord, he'd fished all night long, yet caught nothing. So it can be feast or famine. What else about fishermen? Good at telling stories? Is that a euphemism for being liars? my maternal grandfather was a fisherman, not commercial, but just loved to fish, and that's where some of mine came from. But I remember he had this plaque, and I won't quote it exactly, but he said, fishermen, early to bed, early to rise, fish like crazy, and make up lies. Yeah, we like to tell how long our fish were. You know, in fact, I was fishing this morning over at Swartner's Ranch, and didn't catch very many, but the ones I caught, they were nice. You know, another thing that I think about fishermen when we think they may stink. You know. My granddaughter, my youngest granddaughter, took her fishing one day and catch a few fish, and she wants to kiss every one of them before you put them back, you know, catch and release. Fishermen might stink, but another thing is not only might they not smell so good, but they might be good at making excuses. You know, a lot of the fishermen, I had this fun fisherman friend of mine when we lived in St. Joseph, Louisiana, the sportsman's capital of the world, right? But Sanford was his name, and Sanford was in his late 80s when we were, you know, fishing, having fun. But I just recall that when we'd go fishing, which was quite regular, he would always have some excuse for why we didn't catch more than what we did. You know, the moon was bright the night before, or the front came through, or they fed earlier today. Or fishermen are good at making excuses. And yet Jesus says to these fishermen, and these are fishermen who in all likelihood had been looked over when it came time to become disciples of the rabbi. So they're getting a second chance in life to get to follow the rabbi. Jesus picked fishermen of all people. Why, I don't know. But I do know that fishermen, like farmers, have to be people of great faith, hard work. Sports fishermen today, I mean, I catch fish for the fun of it. Catch them on one side of the boat and throw them back in on the other side of the boat. Just for fun. Same way with, you know, playing golf. You hit it into the hole and you pick it up and hit it again. You know what? It's just recreation. It's just fun. It's leisure time. But these are not recreational fishermen. These are people who make their livelihood fishing. So in Luke chapter 5, the story of Jesus calling to Simon, Jesus said, you caught anything? And he said, no. He said, put out into the deep. Let down your nets. And indeed, they do catch a lot of fish. A fisherman who can obey the master can be a person who catches a lot of fish. In my circles, I belong to a bass club, fishing club down in Austin, and one of the members just helped get started, restarted an event called Fishers of Men. It's a bass tournament kind of thing. And I noticed on his shirt, on the back of his shirt, it says soul fishing. S-O-U-L, soul fishing. Fishing for the souls of men to try to bring them out of the deep, to bring them to Christ. So, again, why Jesus called fishermen, we don't know, but it seems like they were good candidates. It shows us, too, that he associated with, fraternized with the working class people, and that he was delighted to have them to be a part of the kingdom outreach program. They didn't have to have seminary degrees and all these kinds of things. All they needed was faith. And they showed what they believed about Jesus sometimes turned out incorrect. But the fact that they put their trust in Jesus was right on, as in the case with Peter walking on the Sea of Galilee. You've all seen this symbol, this fish symbol. Can you bring that up, Barbara? Do we have it? Yeah, there it is. Do you understand this as a Christian symbol? The word in the middle is an acronym. It spells fish in Greek, ichthus, but each of the letters stand for Jesus Christ, God's Son, Savior. Jesus Christ, God's Son, Savior. There it is, right there. And that I've typed it out that way. So ichthus, the I for Jesus, the it's not an X, it's a chi, which would be like for our CH, Christ, right? Theus, God, Theus. Weos, Son, and soterion is our Savior. So Jesus Christ, God's Son, Savior. Someone once said that in times when people were persecuted for being Christians, and you might get your head cut off if you say, hey, did you read John chapter 3:16? Something like that. Instead of saying, are you a Christian? They would take their foot and make that arc in the dirt. You know? And if the person were a Christian, they would know to come make the other side of that arc to make it look like that fish. And, oh, okay. Good to meet you, brother, sister. And not have to worry about getting yourself persecuted or killed. Fishing. One of the great industries of the Palestine area, lot of good things happening there, but not a whole lot of money. So we're talking about the Sea of Galilee, northwest corner, where Jesus would headquarter, but he would travel across the sea and down all around many, many times. Sea of Galilee. I don't know how many names there are for the Sea of Galilee, but again, you see it's way up in the northern part up there. The Sea of Galilee has a lot of other names. One is, they argue that the Hebrew word for harp, you know, like playing the harp, is kinnor, K-I-N-O-R. Do I have a slide for that, Barbara? Kinnor? And do some of your Bibles, especially King James, sometimes refer to the Sea of Galilee as the Sea of Kinnereth or Chinnereth. You've seen that? You're looking at me like you've never seen that before. We're not going to Cana yet, so hold that slide. So Kinnereth would be a Hebrew name for Galilee. But remember, the Sea of Galilee gets its name, again, from the word Galilee. And Galilee means a circle of peoples, circle of people. And that is probably because all of these people, go to the map now. Go to the map now, Barbara, please. And so if you look again at Galilee, the area of Galilee, there's Galilee right there. It would at times have been surrounded by Phoenicians and Ammonites and Moabites and Syria up north and those kind of, and so it was surrounded by all these different folks. And again, remember too that over here in what would be Moab, that nowadays we would call it Jordan. Prior to that, it was called the Nabataeans, and thus we would go down to see Petra, the land of the Nabataeans. Sea of Galilee, a lot of different names. It's not that big a lake, really, 33 miles of shoreline, I'm told. It's about 8 miles wide and 13 miles long, 64 square miles. If you've ever been, let's see, it's a lot bigger than most of the lakes around here. It's really not that big. Consider, but it is the lake in Israel and the primary source of water and resources for fishing. All right, we're moving on because we're almost done here. Jesus is walking along the shore. He sees these fishermen, and I assume it's fairly early in the morning. It seems that they often fished at night, I would assume, especially in the summertime. I know when I fish in the summertime, I fish at night a lot because it's hot in the daytime, right? So they fish at night, and perhaps it can be more productive, but Jesus comes upon these fellows, and oftentimes they have been unproductive, but Jesus tells them how to catch fish. They do, and there's a miracle, and they decide that, I think this is the kind of guy that I can follow. When Jesus finds them and calls them to be disciples, they probably have heard him speak, teach, preach before. It's not like this is the first time they've ever seen him. I doubt that. Word gets around quickly, doesn't it? And they'd heard about him. But they're there mending their nets, washing their, preparing, getting ready for tomorrow night. When you drag those nets, they could get some grass, limbs from trees, that nearby the lake that fall in. I don't guess they had to worry about any beer cans. But cleaning their nets, getting ready for the stuff you have to do. And in the midst of that, Jesus calls some of these men to come follow him, and they leave their nets. Now, I think that's more than just a literal left their nets. I mean, if they leave their nets, then they leave their way of life. They leave their, it's like leaving your job. As I understand it, you can make a living fishing, but you need to keep fishing. Most people didn't have great bank accounts that, get your IRA built up and you can afford to follow Jesus. You had to have faith to follow Jesus, and evidently they did. So we're going to come back to Capernaum numerous times. Remember, Jesus will leave Capernaum, he'll go places, but he comes back again and again. A great place to be. It's a bit of a political place in the sense that there's a lot of traffic. You've got people coming from all over. Tiberias, a little further south on the western side of the Sea of Galilee, is the larger town. In fact, it's a place where we stay when we go and visit Israel. So let's go to Cana. Remember the city of Cana? Cana of Galilee. In fact, I'm going to John in my Bible, John chapter 2, verse 1. You can go there with me if you'd like. John chapter 2, verse 1. And this is where on the third day there was a wedding in Cana, in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus was invited to the wedding and his disciples. And when the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, they have no wine. And Jesus said to her, woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come. And his mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. There were 6 stone water jars there for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding about 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. They filled them up to the brim, and Jesus said to them, now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast. And so they took it. And when the master of the feast tasted the water, now become wine, and did not know where it came from, although the servants who drew the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, now, we know everyone serves the good wine first, and when people have drunk freely, then they give the poor wine, the cheap stuff. But you have kept the good wine until now. This was the first of the signs Jesus did at Cana in Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. Now, I have here a bottle of wine, wedding wine from Cana. I save that, and for all the marriages I do, if they want to take communion, they take some communion wine. Isn't that neat? You might like to see that. You want to touch it? Yeah. Taste it? Yeah. By the way, when you visit Cana and go to the place, you can actually, they'll set aside a place for you to renew your vows. They have plenty of little shops where you can buy things like this. Yeah. Cana. What does Cana mean? Some have suggested it means like a reed, you know, the reed that grows up in the edge of the water, like a swampy place. Yeah. For us, the importance is it's the first miracle that that's been recorded that Jesus did. First miracle. But John doesn't call them miracles. He calls them signs. S-I-G-N. Signs. They are signs. What does a sign do? It indicates something else, right? You know, like a sign will say, go this way, go that way. A sign. And so the sign points to something greater than itself. And this sign, this miracle of changing water into wine, is pointing that Jesus is the living water. He is the Messiah. He is the Son of God. He is the one that we're looking for. All right. I want to go real quick to John chapter 4, verse 46. John 4, 46. Just because we're walking in the footsteps of Jesus. So he, that is Jesus, came again to Cana in Galilee, where he had made the water wine. And at Capernaum, there was an official. So we know that he traveled numerous times to Cana. We all know also that Nathanael, you know, the disciple Nathanael? John 21, 2 says Nathanael of Cana. So while he was there, he picked himself up a disciple. Huh? Yeah. So we went up to Cana, not that, well, it's just a little north of Nazareth. So if we're looking at the Sea of Galilee right here, right, we're coming down and over a little bit to Cana, just north of Nazareth. And then we'll go back to Capernaum. We'll go back up there because next week when we get together, we're going to Jerusalem. We've been there before. In fact, we've been there numerous times if we had literally followed Jesus, because we have indication that regularly Joseph and Mary and the family would go to Passover at least. And that's what we're going to do, is we're going with Jesus to the first Passover recorded during his ministry period. So if you want to take a look at that, that's where we're going, Jerusalem. It may begin to get tough from here. We're going to see as Jesus starts out, he preaches a pretty hard sermon. Steps on your toes. Create some enemies. But he also has people coming to him by the multitudes. We're following him. Pray with me. Father, we bow before you again tonight to say thank you for a good day. We pray, Lord, your blessing as we travel to our homes. We pray for a good night's rest. We pray for peace. Peace not only in our hearts, but in this world. We pray for peace in our minds. Lord, there's so much troubling things in our world. Help us to trust in you. That's the source of our peace. Thank you for Jesus, the fact that you sent your only begotten Son, that he walked among us, showed us how to live, and empowered us to live in right relationship with you by your grace. Lord, bless us and let us be a blessing to others. Help us to be soul fishermen. In Jesus' name, amen.